Hey, well, thanks for coming out. I did Great Decisions a long time ago, I think about 12 years ago, and if anybody remembers, it was also on Russia. So I understand this is not a group to be taken lightly. So in fact, a couple months ago, I was asked if I would do, because you know, Great Decisions obviously is a nationwide program, and so everybody's doing this topic this month. And so the group down at McDaniel College needed someone to go down, and I says, well, I know I'm doing the War College on the 20th, so I'll go down there, and that'll be my dry run. And none of them know me, and then I'll be all ready, you know. But that was February 3rd, but actually it's been a moving target. So I could have just, I had to update quite a lot, actually, between then and now. So I understand, you know, so I did the reading and watched the video, and it's a good video. I was impressed on actually how up-to-date it was. It sounds like they didn't really finish it until the end of last year, based on the interviews and all that. So we'll just get in it, and I'll give you just kind of my overview on the topic, and then the Q&A is always the most fun, and we may have a break in between, and you know, then we'll get to that. So, okay. Let's see if I get this to work. All right, so I'm going to have to get where I can see this a little better, actually. Basically, see it. So, I mean, one thing to keep in mind, in terms of whatever we do with Russia, and our policy and what's going on in that part of the world, some things aren't going to change. I mean, the geopolitical attributes of Russia will not change. It's still going to be a big country with a lot of people, not as many as the Soviet Union, but still a lot, you know, with what's left. And it's going to span vast time zones and climates. And, you know, it has the attributes of at least a regional power. So they may be down and out, but they're always going to be at least that. And we know they have aspirations for more than that. the articles talked a little bit, you know, it started with the post-Soviet period. And you've probably heard this, but this is an interesting chart to see it in, you know, some of the data on it. This was like, I think, the only case in this part of history, this time in history, when life expectancy has gone down in a country. So from the post-Soviet era, you know, to it dipped especially, it got down into, even for the men, into the 50s, into like the mid-50s, you know, about like 92, 95, and it's working its way back up. So you can see the males are worse off than the females. And that was due mainly to alcoholism, drug addiction, and all kinds of sort of societal ills, many of which are still going strong there. By comparison, if we look at, I stole this from the Dutch guy who came to visit, that we have our student from the Netherlands right here, and we had a expert from The Hague come within the last couple weeks, and he shared this slide with us, which shows, okay, well, so how does that compare to everyone else? And you see tucked in there Estonia. So I put them up there because they were former Soviet Union. But look, 20 years later, they're kind of off the charts, you know, compared to those left behind the pack, as far as that goes. Okay, your reading started out with foreign policy in the 90s. So it is kind of do an overview of where we kind of pick up the story. So, you know, NATO expansion was the big storyline throughout the 1990s. And of course, now that once Putin's in, he sees this as sort of the root of all evil. You know, so he says the NATO expansion is a direct threat to the security of our country, talks about being encircled, talks about, you know, how threatening this is. And, you know, what I find interesting is, okay, you know, I'm sure you've read a lot about this, and you've seen the people talking about this on TV, and everybody's just kind of putting that out there, like, oh, we should have known better, and why didn't we anticipate? And then I'm like, oh, wait a minute, what should we have done differently? You're really not going to let the Baltic states and NATO, you know, who we never even recognized as part of the Soviet Union, because they were just basically, you know, inappropriately annexed. The whole time they were part of the Soviet Union, we never recognized the Baltic states as part of the Soviet Union. What are they supposed to do for their security? And if they want to follow the Western values, you know, human rights and equality for all and all that, that can really only happen under a democratic system. And so I would challenge those people who say those things. Okay, so what should we have done? And just the last 2 days, and this will come up a little bit on the presentation, I was at a conference in New Orleans. The International Studies Association meets every year somewhere. And I went out to dinner with my dissertation advisor, who's now in his 80s. And this came up. And he's like, oh, everybody's full of it. Who says that? You know, this big international relations, you know, star professor guy. And I'm like, yeah, you're the only one I've heard say this. I've been saying that, but I haven't seen it anywhere else. So anyway, you know, so that's part of their storyline. The other thing I think we have to keep in mind as we talk about especially the Russian perspective and any other perspective is that they have a distinct storyline that they tell, a distinct narrative, which doesn't need to be fact-based, you know, it just needs to follow. And we'll see, often it's completely not fact-based, which makes it pretty hard to deal with people like that, with entities like that. So then going back to the early 90s was actually a period of hope. You know, under Yeltsin, we were very optimistic. I'm sure a lot of you guys probably on active duty even back then. It was really, really exciting what could happen with the U.S.-Russian relationship, and especially the military relationship. And then, you know, things just didn't quite go that way. And I remember about 10 years into it, and I was listening to a panel somewhere in the media, I think it was somewhere on NPR or something like that, and they had a panel of, you know, Soviet experts, and the question was, 10 years later, all you Soviet experts, what happened? Why aren't things going like the way we thought they were going to go 10 years ago? And one of the panelists said, which always stuck with me, said, you know, there's one thing we underestimated, how greedy everyone would be. You know, that they were just all out for themselves. There were no founding fathers of the Russian Federation. You know, so basically, you know, the state owned everything. And if you were part of the apparatchiki in the Soviet era, you were in line to become, you know, the head of Gazprom or, you know, whatever. And you would be a billionaire overnight, which is an interesting thing that I think also gets lost even in the reporting today. We know about the oligarchs, and now they're the oligarchs. And they've got all these billionaire oligarchs and all that. We're trying to sanction them, you know, so they put the pressure on Putin. But what I think kind of gets lost is there's one of the things Putin does not tolerate are the oligarchs who get the money by private means, by a private corporation. So you remember Khodorkovsky, he was the Yukos, the head of Yukos Oil, who started to use his wealth to fund opposition parties, and you don't think Putin's gonna go for that? So they figured out some way, you know, they you know, brought trumped up charges against him, broke up the entire company. He was in jail for a long time, you know, to send the message, you don't challenge us like that. And so as long as you're ahead of a state company, which the Kremlin basically controls, they're okay with you being a billionaire because you know what the deal is. You're not gonna, you know, do anything against the Kremlin or this or that. It's a little bit of a side story. But what didn't happen? You know, why was this period so brief? The leaders, they weren't focused on democratic institution building. They were focused on basically looking out for themselves and, you know, assuming these state entities for themselves. And then other things happened in the 90s, as you remember, and actually this started under Yeltsin with the war in Chechnya. There were a couple of phases of it. And then, you know, we thought they were going to follow international norms and just embrace all the Western values and all this. But, you know, it turns out in that conflict and then also in the Balkans, they started to run afoul, you know, in their behavior in those places. And so we started this falling out was kind of, you know, gradual. Okay, then Putin comes along. And as we know, his focus is on the state and, you know, building the strong state. And so I mean, you can look at the overall narrative as, you know, the strong state all the way through. You've got Tsarist Russia, you've got Soviet Russia, now you've got Putin Russia. So, you know, what's the common theme there? He created what it's come to be known as the vertical of power. So all the way up kind of the chain command is kind of locked in. Under Yeltsin, governors were elected. And, you know, some of them were even kind of challenging him a little bit. And they were sort of, you know, starting to go their own way, like what happened in a state, you know, here in the United States, you know, some are doing their own thing and this and that. And part of, you know, getting, controlling that was getting rid of that process, and the governors then became appointed by the Kremlin. So he controls, you know, all of that as well. As we said before, there's no toleration of the opposition. So he basically, but meanwhile, the economy is doing okay because the oil and gas was coming along. So, and we'll have a slide on that. And his legitimacy will be based on that. This is a little bit of a side, that makes, maybe finish this and then I'll go back to the side story. So when we talk about, you know, what helps to keep leaders in power, you know, like in political science or anywhere else, you know, one of the things we talk about is what's their legitimacy based on. So, you know, in a democratic state, there's democratic legitimacy because the people elected that leader and that, and based on their constitution and all that. But in a non-democratic state, so Putin doesn't have the democratic legitimacy to fall back on, although he was elected. It's questionable, you know, how fair and free those elections are, and if, and now that he's been, you know, reelected at will, or he just changed his jobs with Medvedev or, you know, whatever, that the elections are pretty meaningless now. So you can't really say it's democratic legitimacy. But you often see that in authoritarian states, they still have legitimacy based on economic legitimacy. So think of China and now Putin, when the times were good, people, you say, why do people go along with it? Well, because look, life's actually gotten better under these people. So as long as you can deliver on the economic goods and they're not used to these other things because the whole democratic transition, you know, didn't go well, they never really had it. And in fact, they blame, it was the worst of times in that period of transition right after Yeltsin got in. And so they decided, they kind of correlate that with democracy. And then we've got groups that, you know, feed that kind of perception. So, you know, so what's finally happening though, so this is what we need to watch though, because as the sanctions kick in, and as we know what's going on with oil prices kicks in, because the Russian budget is based on a price per barrel. I think it's $100 a barrel. Is that right, Gert? It's 80 from a study. And so if it's below 50, that's a problem. Okay, so if these prices stay low and don't get back up to 80 or more, it throws it all off. So we know the economic projections aren't good based on just the impact of sanctions and the oil prices together, because it's a one-trick pony economy. So if they haven't got anything else going, and if these other strategies kick in, if Europe actually diversifies its energy and they become less dependent on Russia, which is what they want to do long-term. So that's, you know, this sort of social contract. So that's somewhat in question. So a long-term strategy would be, we would want to try to keep, you know, getting at the vulnerabilities in that social contract. Going back to his the foreign policy, you've heard a lot about how he focuses on the ethnic Russians, you know, in the near abroad, in the states that used to be part of the Soviet Union. And again, when I was at this panel in New Orleans watching 2 days ago, somebody did some research on this. It was interesting because it was a professor who had visited Ukraine before any of this started in 2013, like right before it all started in the summer of 2013. And her specific research topic was what is going on with ethnic Russians in Ukraine. And what she found, said, first of all, before 1991, so before the breakup of the Soviet Union, they called them migrants. They were migrants within the USSR. After 1991, that's when Russia started calling them minorities. And she said in the 2001 census, when you asked these ethnic Russians, what do you identify as, a Ukrainian or a Russian? 77% of those who are ethnic Russians, just that percentage, identified as Ukrainians, and 72% is Russian. Now, I have an identity expert in the room. Is this right, Bob? Is this checked? I'm just going off of what I heard a couple days ago. But anyway, you can elaborate on that in the Q&A. But Russia did have a strategy. They were trying to promote dual citizenship. They were trying to, you know, kind of get their hooks into these people however they could. But these governments resisted that. They said, no, we don't want that. We don't, you know, they could see nothing but trouble with, you know, facilitating the dual citizenship of Ukrainians, you know, or Estonians or Latvians or whatever it was. And then they were kind of doing that all along, and then after 2004, they stepped it up again after the Orange Revolution, which we'll talk about in a minute. But still, there weren't many people interested in that. And I've seen other, I'll talk about that, I've seen other survey data, which will come up in another chart later. Okay. All right, so if we're talking about the overall U.S.-Russian relationship, we're going to talk about a lot about the Ukraine situation today, but we need to put it into perspective. So if you look at our national security strategies, which I'm going to show you in the next couple slides, the last couple, how it's evolved, you could pick out these issues. You know, what do we care about? Probably number one, a stable nuclear relationship, because that is the only country that can, you know, blow us to smithereens still on the planet. So we can't ignore that. We're interested in their cooperation to get what we want with the Iran nuclear negotiations. We need them for counterterrorism. They were very important to facilitate our operations in Afghanistan and in that region. They're a key issue with Syria, and they're the ones who have the main leverage with Assad. Of course, Russia's the main energy supplier to our allies in Europe. And then there's a crisis in Ukraine, and Crimea is not even on there. So it's like, when you think of the great scheme of things, those top few interests seem, if you were to prioritize their interests, are pretty up there compared to what's going on with the crisis in Ukraine. So just to illustrate that a little bit further, if you looked at the national security strategy that came out in May 2010, there's only one paragraph on Russia, okay, and this is it. And so, if you just see what's underlined, I was trying to underline what the interests were. So we said we had an interest in a strong, peaceful, prosperous Russia that respects international norms. We work together to advance nonproliferation. Help us with confronting violent extremism, especially Afghanistan. And at the very end, we say something about support the sovereignty and territorial integrity of Russia's neighbors. There's nothing really negative in that, you know? So this is a little bit of homework I had to do between now and February 3rd, because guess what happened? A new national security strategy came out just last Friday. So I'm like, well, I have to see what's in that. So I did the search, and now in the new national security strategy, it's all about Russian aggression, right? That wasn't on the map in the 2010 strategy. So now, number one sentence, Russian aggression in Ukraine makes clear that European security and the international rules and norms against territorial aggression cannot be taken for granted. So much for that other paragraph about, we hope they stick with the international norms. So we've sort of given up on that for a while. And then we skip down. What else do we want? We want to deter further aggression, work with Europe to improve its energy security, support these partners where Russia's already played its playbook out. The Georgian War, Moldova, these were where the other frozen conflicts are, right? So we know the Abkhazia region, Transnistria is a little sliver of Moldova. That's kind of this frozen conflict that Russia's dominates. And that's what they're after in Ukraine. And then at the end, we talk about provide for their own defense. Anybody notice, like, what doesn't it say? Does this seem, I mean, obviously this is more forceful than the other one because things have happened to lead to the rewriting of it. But what doesn't it say? Okay, I think that'll be in there somewhere, though. Actually, I have another slide. But you're right, it's not there. War on Terror. Okay, let me look at the second slide real quick. There's two slides on this. So let's see what the other one. It's basically there are two paragraphs. So we'll continue to improve costs. So the beginning, they're talking about the sanctions. Again, we want to deter Russian aggression. We'll keep the door open to collaboration with areas of common interests. I think elsewhere in the document, it did say something about non-proliferation. Because actually what I did is I ended up doing a search of the two documents, and I looked for the word Russia. And it came up, I think the first one, 12 times, 2010, 2015, 15 times, so not that many more. But then I looked at the context within which it came up. So, of course, the first one, it was all pretty positive. There wasn't really, the second one, Russia was, the next word was aggression, like 9 of the times, okay? 9 of the 15 times. A couple times, I think it was mentioned the nuclear interests. And a couple times was mentioned sanctions. But it was pretty much all in a negative sort of light. The other word that doesn't come up at all is Crimea. It's not even mentioned. So, and if you look at the previous paragraph, we would deter further Russian aggression. There's nothing like we're going to roll back aggression. We're going to get Crimea back. It's just all about, you know, so that doesn't necessarily even mean, you know, roll back what's going on in Ukraine. So I thought that was interesting because with your instruments of power, you know, you can at least state something a little bit more ambitious than what you might actually do. But, you know, but if it's not even stated, that tells you it's not like really on the radar, you know, for our policy. So there's your update. Made me do my homework, so hopefully I passed that part of the test. You're all in the know on that. So let's just review the timeline a little bit with what's going on with the Russia-Ukraine situation. And your reading went over this somewhat. So, you know, back in the beginning, August 91 is when we get an independent Ukraine. And so the first thing that probably is scaring the Kremlin, of course, Putin's not in yet in 94, but the Orange Revolution. And so I have a picture of that. That's the Orange Revolution. And so explain that in a minute. So what happened was one candidate got elected, but the observers, and there's basically a consensus that that's not the candidate who should have been elected, that election was rigged. And so the people supporting the candidate who did not win but should have won, Yushchenko, the color of his party was orange. So that's why they went out into Maidan and, you know, had these mass protests. Got the attention of the Supreme Court. So, you know, the democratic institutions were actually coming along. I mean, they did allow, you know, the fact that this could even be reversed. So ultimately it was reversed by the Ukrainian Supreme Court. And Yushchenko was put in power. But then, but the thing with Ukraine, without getting all the details, it's the back and forth. So you had, well, I like this map, because if you look, I think this has a, does this have a laser thing on it? No, maybe not. But if you look on the right side, the darker blue areas, so you know the eastern part is more, you know, where the ethnic Russians are, and that's more pro-Russian. And then the lighter blue over to the west, that's more pro-Europe. And you can see these are the breakdowns who they voted for. Okay, so the percentage who voted for the pro-Russian candidate in 2010, who was Yanukovych. So he's the guy who actually would have gotten in 2004 if the election had not been overturned, but he stayed in the system. So you have to give Ukraine a little bit of credit in terms of the difference between Ukraine and Russia in this period is that they would actually have an election and throw the other person out. It was possible for the opposition to get in, and it was kind of this back and forth. Whereas in Russia, you know, once Putin got in, that wasn't possible. Okay, so they're a little ahead on the democratization as far as that goes. But the problem was, whoever got in was as corrupt as the other one and didn't do anything to build the democratic institutions, reform the military, reform the economy, any of that. Okay, and so they did, overall, they still weren't making progress. And then keep in mind, another just sort of interesting footnote. So Crimea, 78% goes for the pro-Russian candidate. So when you annex Crimea, and the elections, they were always close. That's why they were always, you know, it was kind of like a 50-50 thing. But once Russia annexed Crimea and it becomes part of Russia, what does that do for the next election? Because we've had an election since then. They're not so close anymore because you just took a million pro-Russian voters out of the mix. So that's one of the downsides for the annexation, I guess. But okay, so this is when the whole Maidan protests and all that really started in November 2013, when there was this kind of this fight over which way are we going to go, more toward the EU or more toward Russia. So Yanukovych, he's president now, and Putin's pretty putting big pressure on him not to sign a deal with the EU. This was not like I'm going to be in the EU or anything like that. It was just some type of baby steps, some type of economic agreement with the EU, and put, you know, a ton of pressure on. And in the end, Yanukovych caves and says, okay, I said I was going to sign it, but now I'm not going to sign it. And that's when there started to be some protests. Now, at first, it wasn't much. Apparently, it was just like a few students who went out. The thing that got it bigger was when there was some violence, enacted against these students. And that got the attention of the broader population. And then they started coming out in big numbers. So again, the first raid was only 35 or so, but it's starting to get some attention. By December, they're occupying the city hall, and those are tents. I'm gonna have some other pictures of the tents. So this is the main Maidan, Independence Square. And there's a massive 800,000 people pro-European demonstration at this time. Okay, this is occupying government buildings. Now, just this little anecdote. Notice they're wearing these hard hats. So this became sort of a symbol of the protesters, that they were wearing these hard hats. So hold that thought for a second. I'm going to come back to it. Just remember the hats. You're going to see them again. This is just more of the protests. That is like Yulia Tymoshenko. So part of the soap opera from the previous Orange Revolution thing. She was with Yushchenko. She was his prime minister, right? And then once Yanukovych got in, again, he, not to be outdone by Putin and his types, he's like, I can trump up charges just like anybody else, and found a way to put her in jail. So she was on jail. She was in there up until this point. I think up until he fled the country, and then once the follow-on government came in, they let her out. And for a while, she wanted to be run for president, and I'll get to that in a second, but in the end. But anyway, that's who she is. All right, so then we're going to getting to the end of 2013. So Putin does this last-ditch effort. He says, you know, I'll give you $15 billion, I'll buy, you know, $15 of your debt, we'll give you a discount on the gas. And, you know, again, still trying to change your mind. Meanwhile, Yanukovych is still trying to crack down on the protests. Now, Russia has various anti-protest laws, which apparently they looked at as a model for the Ukrainian anti-protest laws. And part of the verbiage in the laws was, you're not allowed to wear helmets when you protest. So just think about this. Do you think, first of all, are protesters going to follow, like, the regulation of the anti-protest law? So of course they get their hands on that, and what do they do? Well, hey, can we get to that in a second? I'll go back to that. That's the protest. So that's what they look like. You remember last year that the vortex and all that. It was really super cold. So there it is. So actually, in February, about this time last year, about a week before, I was actually there. I mean, coincidentally, I was sent to do. It was a long time scheduled trip to do some mill-to-mill educational work with their National Defense University. Because I remember the week or two before I left was when they first started having some violence in Maidan, and I kept talking to my handler, like, are we still going on this trip? Oh yeah, no, it's still on, everything's fine, it's good. Are you sure? Oh yeah, it's good. You know, everything's on, everybody's good. And I'm like, okay, you know, so I went, I was actually by myself. And so I gave my workshop one day. And then that evening of after the first day, and there weren't any tours or anything because, you know, the tourism had died down. You know, people were, the bus tours and all of that stuff was running during all this protest that was going on. But I went to the concierge and I said, what about the ballet? How's that? Oh yeah, the ballet's still going. And I could just walk down from my hotel. So I'm like, okay, get me a ticket to the ballet. So I went down, it was the Nutcrackers, wonderful, you know, this and that. And then at the intermission, I'm just looking at this beautiful theater, you know, where they're doing it. And I'm taking some pictures, and this older woman said, oh, are you an American? And, you know, like in speaking English, I'm like, well, yeah, you know, it turns out she's a Canadian who was visiting. She's Ukrainian-Canadian, and she comes over every year for a couple months, rents an apartment, and she does, like, aid work in hospitals. So anyway, she's like, oh, I know the cellist, and we're going out for a drink after. So what do you say? I said, okay. So we went to this little thing next to the opera or the ballet thing. And then it was time to go. I was going to walk the 10 minutes back up to my hotel. And she goes, oh, have you been to the Maidan yet? I'm like, oh, no, no. In fact, I was told I shouldn't go there. You know, I had this email that says don't go down there. And she goes, oh, that's ridiculous. You've come all this way. She goes, I go there all the time. Let's go. And so I'm like, okay, I mean, I'm with Luba, but she's got her cane, and she'll, like, beat off anybody that gives us trouble, you know? And so we just walked down, and so before we knew it, we were there. I was there. I took that picture in the city hall. So we went to the city hall. They'd taken over to city hall. So going back to the story about the helmets and all that, so then all of a sudden, when they tried to take their helmets away, so then these became the absolute symbol. And so they started decorating the helmets like the Ukrainian Easter eggs, right? So that was the symbol. So that was like a nice little sort of anecdote. So again, this would have been like a week before I was there, but it's all kind of building up. They're trying to work out an agreement with the protesters. So you have like all these high-level people working out an agreement, but the problem was the protesters didn't go along with it. You know, they wouldn't actually implement it. So you see, they rejected the conditions. And they're like, because what it would have been, it was Yanukovych would have stayed. There would have been an election later that year. And they would have kind of started the sort of the process of reconciliation. Like, no, we don't want him. We're going to stay here until he goes. this is a picture I took. This was right across from my hotel. That's the founder of the city. Just keep that in mind, because that's like another symbol of the city of Kiev. This is going to come up again in a second. And he's facing this old St. Sophia's Cathedral from like 11th, 12th century, another symbol. And then these are pictures I took that night in February of basically the tent city, walking around. That says Kiev City Hall, okay, which was inside where those helmets were. And this is inside. This is my favorite thing inside. This is just a homemade poster. But this was their symbol, because here's this guy again, who's a symbol, kind of the symbol of the city. And then in Russian, it says to Europe, and the E is the euro, right? So it's kind of a cool thing. And then, of course, you got the flag around his weapon there, or, you know, whatever that is. So that was nice. That says revolution, just outside one of the tents. Of course, those are the flags. Blue and gold flags. So more of that. That says information center for the protest. And then, again, it was really, really cold. So I'm keeping warm with these fires and all that. And that's the last picture I took the day before I left. And keep in mind, it's not a great picture, but it looks pretty normal. You know, this is the mine on the main square. You can see they have like these big TV screens. So they regularly had people basically every day. Who are the speakers? They're getting up on the stage. You can see it from afar, you know, very organized. Right around the corner was the post office. I went there and mailed my postcards, just walked right there. There's a metro stop there. There's people just walking through, you know, going back and forth to work. Although you do have to go through kind of a little checkpoint with some guy with a mask, but you still were, you know, you're still walking through. They were selling souvenirs and also useful things for protests. Like you could buy your black woolen mask there, and your gloves. And I meant to bring it. It's in my office. I bought like these little ribbons that basically were EU symbols with the Ukrainian flag. So, you know, okay, buy your protest souvenirs, you know, and all that kind of stuff. And then, you know, about 10 days later, wait, it looks like that. So then that's when it really got violent. And I go back to the details here a second. So by mid-February, remember, they wouldn't accept the protest, and it gets a direct confrontation. At first, 18 were killed, hundreds wounded. Then it gets even worse. 88 people were killed there. And there was talks of snipers firing into the crowd. And there's a big discussion about who gave that order, and all that kind of thing. Again, this forces Yanukovych to sign this deal to against this new national unity government. We're going to have these constitutional changes, this and that. But protesters won't take it. So, and you notice the rubble. What this is, if you remember, it was cobblestone. If you could tell that from the first thing. So what happened was they dug up the cobblestones and started use them as projectiles. And the talks are like, you'd have the babushkas out there digging them up, giving them to whatever, you know. And I did notice, you know, from being there, it was seemed very grassroots. It was all kinds of people were there. There were a lot of like Orthodox priests that were participating. You know, there were older people, there were younger people. It seemed like it was a cross section. Okay. So events move quickly. And Yanukovych flees, and the parliament says, okay, and this is a big controversy, we get this in Q&A if you want, but, you know, United States will say, hey, they followed a parliamentary procedure, that the president left the country, so they did what they could to, you know, kind of go from there, and they set new elections for several months later. Then almost immediately, what happens? Putin's like, okay. So I don't know. What I think personally was going on is he lost his gamble. I mean, he was trying to entice Ukraine to stay in the fold using his soft power, if that's not an oxymoron with Putin, but, you know, using his soft power of throwing money into the black hole of the Ukrainian economy. He didn't have any trouble doing that if he could keep him in the fold. IMF, you know, whatever we do, the West is going to give him money. We're going to insist on, you know, certain structural reforms and this and that. You know, and that's all what's going on now. But, you know, even with all that pressure, they went the other way. So, you know, he's thinking, this is not an example I want, you know, for Moscow. And who knows how long this was in the works. I mean, if I've heard all kinds of things from, well, you know, the Olympics had just been going on. I mean, I think that one of the reasons it was quiet the week I was there, it was the week the Olympics were starting. So, you know, you don't want to do this, you know, when your big Olympics are going on in Sochi. But also, there were a lot of military movements associated with the Olympics, you know, for the security, also in the Black Sea. And Sochi was off the Black Sea. So that could have masked, you know, whatever was going on, or they used those as they're coming back from the Olympics, or, and of, you know, whatever. And of course, they had the Black Sea feet. The Black Sea Fleet in Crimea, and the troops were already there, right? So you just take those Marines they didn't have to necessarily come from somewhere else. So those are the famous little green men you've heard about, who, you know, in hindsight we think they're some type of Russian special forces who've probably been trained just to do this. No identifiers, but they, you know, do those look like just volunteers? They all look, they're dressed the same, and boy, that's kind of nice. All your uniforms look the same. I'm sure all your military experts can see this. This looks pretty much like an organized group of people with some training, as far as that goes. Okay, so just to kind of skip through some of this. So we know what happens, you know, Putin annexed Crimea, the sanctions kick in. Then we just start having this back and forth. Okay, fine. We kick you out of the G8. NATO starts to kick in. We're going to stop all of our associations with you. And then it starts in the east. So now we get these Russian separatists occupying government buildings in the eastern cities that you've seen in the news so often. As far as that goes, the elections go on as scheduled. They elect Petro Poroshenko as president. So anybody know anything about him? Where did he make his money? Extra credit for anybody who knows how he made his money. Yeah, they call him the Chocolate King. His nickname is the Chocolate King. So he's also an oligarch. He's a Ukrainian oligarch. But from what I've read, he kind of got his stuff fair and square, if that's possible in that environment. I mean, anybody who had to navigate that non-rule of law, making money environment. But he took over all of the chocolate factory base in Ukraine and modernized it, and it's called Roshan chocolate. And when I was there, it's like, and when you travel around this area, for some reason, every country has like their chocolate company, you know, whatever it is, you know, like Estonia, it's Kalev, and you know, this and that. So it was like the main one for Russia. And then I went to their flagship store and then like one nice mall in Kiev, and it was, you know, amazing. So anyway, so he made his billions doing that. But he was always pro-West along the way. And anyway, that's who he is. So then they did actually finally sign the agreement that Yanukovych bailed out on. And things were kind of plugging away. And then we remember in July, we had that shootdown. Because, you know, it kind of fell off the news, and Europe was sort of losing interest. And then all of a sudden, a plane with mainly people from the Netherlands were on that. And, you know, there it is. It was determined that it was some type of projectile, some type of missile. I mean, the consensus is that it was either the Russians did it themselves, or they had to train Ukrainians to do it, or it was at least using the Russian equipment, you know, intentional or not, at least extremely careless, and they're at least accountable for that. So then there's new sanctions. There's more and more. Okay, are these Russians there or not? Well, if they can show that they've got captured paratroopers, these are definitely Russians. If they can show the Russian passports, and all that kind of thing. The NATO commander, General Breedlove, he's been actually pretty outspoken all along on this. I mean, if you're looking at the civil-military relations of it, some people might think sometimes he was a little bit ahead of the policymakers. So, for instance, when there was some question about whether or not the Russian troops were on the border or not, of course, Russia's denying all of this. I mean, Russia still denies all of that. There's no Russian soldiers anywhere. You know, they still say that. He released satellite footage. He tweeted it, I think, and said, look, here's the picture. These are definitely Russian, you know, and apparently he didn't necessarily have political approval to do that, but trying to move along the process by doing that kind of thing. And he's still outspoken to this day, as the NATO leadership has been. So is your countryman just retired, right? Wasn't he Jens Rasmussen? Was he Dutch? Danish. They just had a changing of the guard, and but that political leadership. Well, I want to say political leadership. The leadership, basically, like the Secretary General, he's been outspoken. Both of them, the SACEUR, Supreme Allied Commander of Europe, but they're not the political actors. You know, the nations have not been as outspoken, or they certainly haven't been unified. So this is basically ends the timeline. What we've heard about in the news lately is we're trying to get this ceasefire, which they agreed to, but we know if you've been following the news, they've been violating it, you know, ever since, especially in this one city, Debaltseve, which was apparently like 8,000 Ukrainian troops were trapped there. And the news, the thing recently, they just did the retreat, but there was not compliance with the ceasefire. So unfortunately for Ukraine, who was trying to comply with it, they ended up getting a lot more casualties because the separatists did not follow it, and they suffered a lot there. And Ukraine has ceded this city now to the separatists. And we've also been considering whether or not we'll do lethal aid to Ukraine, and that's just kind of where it stands now in terms of the timeline. So a little bit about the debate on whether or not we should arm them. I'll show you the arguments on both sides, and we can talk about it, but there's actually some, you know, reasonable arguments on either side. Igor Dodler is a former U.S. ambassador to NATO, an academic. Right around February 3rd, when I gave the last talk on this, he and some other experts released a report under the auspices of the Brookings Institution, which was recommending arming the rebels. And their main argument was, well, you know, maybe this isn't going to win a war against the Russians, but the cost that Russia is paying now for what it's doing are not sufficiently high. So their argument is at least raise the cost. And as they looked over history, semi-recent history, like saying going back to the invasion of Afghanistan, said, you know, one of the things that gets the Russians' attention, at least the population, is when more Russian soldiers come home in coffins, people start paying attention. And what Russia has done over these conflicts, you know, going back to Afghanistan, is the coffins just come home. There's no explanation. They don't say where they were, what happened. But after a while, people start putting two and two together. And so they're hoping for that kind of effect. Here's another quote I picked up at the conference I was at just the last 2 days. Andrew Mikta is a regional specialist in this area. and basically said, okay, if we don't give them aid, they're going to lose. And they might lose with it, but it still matters for NATO and European security how Ukraine is lost. You know, did we, you know, try to do anything about it or not? How this all happens, because then the story will be, how was Ukraine lost and how? And we'll be going back and revisiting all that at some point, probably. Okay, here's more on that debate. Those who are against the arming, they'll say, okay, those who are in favor of arming Ukraine, they need to question their assumptions. You know, can we really raise the cost sufficiently high so that Putin will, you know, be deterred at some different threshold? Won't he just double down? They've actually been threatening even the nuclear option. His spokesman has been quoted, you know, in their statements saying things like, only Putin's finger is on the nuclear button. He alone decides. And I was reading something recently. They were comparing sort of Putin's Russia to Soviet Russia, saying in a lot of ways, Soviet Russia was easier for us to deal with. They valued stability more. You know, one of their national interests of Soviet Russia would be just overall stability. And whereas it seems like the goal of Putin's Russia is actually to achieve instability, you know, in certain areas, especially Ukraine. You know, so fine, if they're not going to come to me with my soft power, I'll make sure they're never successful in their quest to go west, and then everyone will see what happened to them. Okay, so maybe hold that thought. The other difference I've seen about the Soviet-Putin-Russia comparison is there were more checks and balances in the Soviet system, because the first secretary of the Communist Party was restrained by the Politburo. There's like nobody restraining Putin. There's nothing like that. So if you remember, you know, the Khrushchev, you know, they kind of kept him in check and this and that. Other arguments against the aid. And there's actually a lot to this, actually. It's not so simple. I mean, anybody who studied the Ukrainian military knows that they didn't, you know, compared to the Russian military, the Russian military has reformed significantly under Putin. They could not have done what they've been doing in the last year and a half, 10 years ago. But with a steady focus on modernization and various reforms and bringing in, getting rid of reducing the ratio between conscripts and professionals and all that kind of stuff, they are a much more capable force. And they spent a lot on equipment and this and that. They've tripled their spending, you know, in recent years, defense spending. Whereas Ukrainian military, again, because it's all this corruption, they haven't been spending much, and what has been spent, there's corruption within the military itself. You know, so it's basically an unreformed, not professional military, and so could they even use the weapon? Could they effectively use them? There's a lot of practical issues with these weapons. I've also read about there's concerns that the intelligence forces have been infiltrated by Russians. So if that's the case, if you've got like basically spies on the Ukrainian side, you know, what would happen with these weapons? Somebody could shoot them at Russia and say that it was Ukraine when it was actually, you know, Russian agents or whatever. I mean, it's really that kind of world of intrigue and all that. And no one's saying it'll be enough to military defeat Russia. No one's saying Ukraine could ever do that with what they have now, with the state of their military. Those are just some sources. So let's talk a little bit about some of these policy options. So now we're like kind of like our war college class now, you know. You have a case and it's like, okay, what do we do? What are our options? And let's, you know, discuss the options. So it seems like, you know, we've gone with these economic sanctions. But the sanctions haven't been having the effect. They haven't been deterred. So now as we reevaluate the policy, what do? Continue the sanctions? Do we escalate them more? Under what conditions would we scale them back? What about the direct military assistance? So this is being discussed. We just talked about that. Putin's great with his information campaign. Where's our counter-information campaign? Is that sufficient? Because it seems like he's beating us on that. What should we do? Some combination of all of this. At the war calls, we talk about DIME, our instruments of power, diplomacy, information, military, economics. But we also talk about what we're going to do depends on what is the intensity of the interest we hold in any situation. So, you know, we had that big list at the beginning, what the U.S. interests were. And really, the Ukraine thing was kind of at the bottom in terms of what are our vital national interests when it comes to U.S. Russia. And I always encourage my students, when you're trying to figure out, you know, some type of strategy or approach, you have to look at the difference in the interests between our interests and every other actor who was pursuing a policy on this. So for the Russians, they see this as vital interests. So if we really think that we can impose a cost sufficient for them to deter their behavior on something that is a vital interest for them, when it's only an important interest for us, and we're not willing to do that much, and what we do actually hurts us when it comes to economic sanctions or hurts our allies, it's not, you know, there's not without a cost to those who are imposing the sanctions, it makes you wonder, you know, how effective that can be. So we can look at, you know, what's the potential? Is there potential for common ground? If you look at what does the West want? We want a stable international order. We would love to see a Ukraine reformed and economically viable. We would like to get back to those first four bullets, because we do have mutual, you know, we have some interests that we need to work together on with Russia. What does Putin want? As far as that first point goes, he's all about, you know, reacting against what he perceives as this American, you know, hegemony. It's this, America wants to freeze in the post-Cold War order, where America kind of runs the world. And Russia's kind of down and out. No, it's all kind of about that. So it's not about the stable international order, because that would be locking in this American sort of primacy from their standpoint. So he needs to undermine that order. So by doing what he did, by annexing Crimea, which violates the most basic norms of the international system, he has absolutely undermined that order and set a bad precedent, you know, for the future continued undermining of that order. He wants to discredit the Western model. So that goes directly against the bullet point, the second one on the left. He wants to make sure Ukraine doesn't succeed, because that just validates the Western model. So he doesn't want, you know, this whole thing to be settled in the East. He wants continued destabilization. It's bleeding the Ukrainian economy. They're spending $5 to $10 million a day on the war. You know, money they don't have. Money, they can't stay focused on all this institution building they need to do. I mean, word is that they've got the right people in now. They don't have the greedy, you know, everything for themselves kind of folks. They've got the right people. The finance minister is a woman, Ukrainian American. I mean, they've got people who want to do the right thing, but. Putin's interest is don't set the conditions so that they can move in the right direction. If continued destabilization will do that, okay? So it's and perhaps further probing, you know, Rasmussen, who just retired as the Secretary General of NATO, was quoted in the paper just like last week saying he absolutely expects more probing from Putin, probably in the Baltics somehow, probably to challenge, how much do we really care about that Article 5 NATO guarantee in the Baltics? You know, because they have it, Ukraine doesn't. So he wants to rewrite the rules of international order. He wants to split the EU and the US. I mean, we just saw this in the negotiations last week. US wasn't really there. It was Germany, France, Russia, Ukraine. You know, that was a little awkward. So Merkel flew to Washington and they went and had a press conference. Oh, yeah, we're all on the same page, you know. But it's well known she is totally against the arming. Meanwhile, you know, Obama's getting pressured by really bipartisan, all kinds of groups towards the arming. And for now, it's just been stalling, saying, well, let's see how the ceasefire goes. But as probably could have been predicted, the ceasefire is not going so well because it really has no interest in ending this necessarily, or at least not now. There's our strategy formulation model just to throw at you. So what would we do? We would consider the interests. Does this bring back any memories for anybody? It hasn't really changed much. Same old thing. We would think about our interests, and we think about what do we want, how would we get it, And all that kind of thing. Anyway, I don't want to give you a headache. This is from the summer, but there's another good one on The Economist last week. It shows Putin just with as a puppeteer, kind of getting his way. There it is. I did get it, actually. That's the one from last week. I couldn't remember if I stayed up in my hotel room to put that in or not. And I get it. I did. Okay. So there he is. Those nice looking eyes. Doesn't that look devious as far as that goes? And I think that's it. Those are some sources. So if anybody wants this, ask me and I can send it to you or write that down, or if you want to look at any of this or look at any of the sources. So I turn over to my leader here, and he's going to decide what we're going to do now.